Alright guys, BLM here, back with a new video, and in this video, with BB22 having just concluded, it's finally time to go ahead and rank every player from the season. Now, like the previous times I've done this type of video, I will be ranking the players here based on how I feel like they played on this individual season. This is not an assessment of them in their careers on the show. Now, so obviously, there are 16 players to rank here, so let's start off with number 16. And the bottom four here for me were very interchangeable. They were all pretty close to each other. I think these are the definitive four worst played games on the season. But for me, the worst game played on this season comes from Nicole Anthony. And for me, a lot of the reason why she's at the very bottom here is because I feel like she's the one that did the most actively bad within her game without much positive within her game either. I don't feel like there's anything to really protect how she did in this game. While there are other people who didn't do well in the game, but they didn't do well due to their reputation before the season or lack of a reputation from before the season, I feel like Nicole Anthony is a player who did bad just because they didn't do well. Like, they just simply didn't play well within the actual context of the season. Now, she is one of the few players to not pregame at all. And I know some people claim that that's the way the game's supposed to be played, but again, this is an all-star season where you know other people are going to be pre-gaming. So by you not pre-gaming, you're essentially lessening your chance of doing well in the game just to what? Like, stand on the moral high ground? I mean, you're not really getting much benefit out of that. And I feel like Nicole is kind of indicative of that. Right off the bat, she comes into the game without many allies. I mean, she does build a bond with Kevin, though also very early on, Kevin is also on the outs, and he is one of the people nominated in the very first week, so that really doesn't do her much. She did have David from relationship on the last season, but again, they didn't really get to do much together. She wanted to work with Tyler. She even says that she's surprised that Tyler never approaches her, but it's like, why didn't you approach Tyler? I mean, like, again, Tyler's in the majority alliance at this point. She isn't. Why is she being so passive in the game? And really, I mean, I guess you could say that about a lot of the cast, is that a lot of the cast played very passively this time. I think that is indicative of where we are within the Big Brother meta right now. But I really do feel like Nicole Anthony did almost everything wrong on this season. Now, she isn't the first boot, so at least you can give her credit for that, I guess. But even then, I mean, she was a potential nominee if the veto had been used, and she is eventually nominated on the second week and does go home in the second week while actively sabotaging her chances of surviving in the game through her being upset at Janelle and Kaser for trying to save her in the game. Like, obviously, she didn't understand the house dynamics. She didn't understand that Kaser and Janelle were also on the bottom with her. But again, that's just another indicative element of her terrible gameplay this season. She had such a bad read on the house. She really had no clue what was going on. She had no true allies within the house outside of the people that she was actively turning away, and Kevin, who was in a terrible spot along with her very early on. So for me, I just feel like there's nothing positive to even bring up for Nicole Anthony here, and nothing to really support her either. So because of that, she lands at the very bottom of the list for me at number 16. Now, number 15 is someone that it does upset me to have to put this person this low. I actually at one point thought about putting this person at the very bottom of the list. And to be honest, I think there is an argument for it. Despite how much I love this person as a character, and as he seems like a great person as well. But at number 15, I do have to put Kaser. And it really sucks to put Kaser this low. I mean, I think Kaser is someone that has an okay strategic mind for the game. I think he is able to read the house pretty well for the most part. I mean, he does have points where he gets pretty bad reads, but a lot of those bad reads come from bad information that he's given by others. So I do think when he gets all the accurate information, he is able to make a mostly accurate read most of the time. And I do think Kaser also got unlucky with his positioning coming into the game, where obviously he was a very well-known pair with Janelle. And while his target wasn't as massive as Janelle's, I do think that was also a hindrance to him as well, because Janelle at least had the concept of like her being kept around as a meat shield, while Kaser didn't really have that. And that's why he was targeted during that first week, where he is able to save himself from the safety suite. But I mean, again, like, he was almost the first boot. Like, if he doesn't win that safety suite comp, he's at least on the block with Keisha. And if he doesn't win veto, he more than likely goes home. But also, when we just look at how the game played out, again, like, he would have been the first boot if that didn't happen. Second round, he only gets saved by the grace of Memphis being one of the few players willing to play individually very early on in the game. And by that, he doesn't put Kaser on the block, as he's relatively close to Kaser. But then after that, we get to week three. He's on the block against Janelle. Again, gets saved because Janelle is a bigger target. But then the very next week, he goes home. He goes home in week four with the only round that he wasn't in danger was the round where Memphis won HOH. And I've talked about this already in my review, but the week that he does go home, I feel like he actively sabotages his positioning at every opportunity. Mind you, I he was already in a bad spot to begin with, but I do think there was a chance he could have survived that week, but he just kept on blowing that up by actively targeting Cody and Tyler still. And at that point that he's at the very bottom, it doesn't really benefit him to still make it open to everyone he's targeting Cody and Tyler. Instead, he should have tried to work with them, and we did see that there was some potential for Enzo wanting to backdoor Danny that week. Now, would it have actually happened? I don't know, but I do feel like this is still an opportunity that Kacer had that he just kind of just threw away. Really, when it comes down to it, I just think Kacer is the same player he was 14 years ago when he played in the original All-Stars and when he played on BB6. Like, he hasn't really changed since then, and because of that, he has a lot of the same faults in the game. And he ends up landing here at number 15. Now, number 14, we have a player that I kind of just mentioned, and that is Janelle. And Janelle's game this season is very tough to assess because, I mean, obviously she came in here with one of the biggest targets on her back. So seeing her go home early isn't that big of a surprise. However, you could say the same thing about Tyler. Like, Tyler came into this season with a massive target on his back as well and was still able to make it to Final Six despite sabotaging his game multiple times as well. You also have Nicole Franzel and Ian, both former winners coming into this game, still able to make it much further than Janelle. So while you obviously have to factor in the fact that she had this massive target on her back coming into the season, that isn't the end-all be-all of her game. Like, she still played pretty poorly outside of that. She spent way too much social capital in those first 2 weeks trying to save people that eventually went home. She tried to save Keisha that entire first week when it was very clear that Keisha wasn't gonna stay, and through that she ruined her relationship with Kevin. During week two, she just spent so much time trying to save Nicole Anthony, only for Nicole Anthony to think that Janelle's trying to get her out, so that does her no good as well, and also ruins her relationship with David. And then we come into the week where she goes home, where, like, because of those previous two rounds, she isn't able to get the support of Kevin and David to keep her in the game at that point, though obviously she was going home anyway. Another thing about Janelle, too, is that I find it so funny how people are so upset at, oh my god, all this pre-gaming that happened that ended up running the game and everything. It's like, we know that Janelle pre-gamed probably harder than any other person on this season. Like, from the preseason, we were hearing about just how much Janelle was pre-gaming. And we see that within the season, where we know that Janelle and Danny pre-game, Janelle and Bailey pre-game, obviously Janelle and Kacer pre-game. Like, Janelle did have a whole bunch of pre-game relationships coming into this season. It's just that she pre-gamed poorly. For her to pre-game that much and still come into the house in such a terrible position, and for her to come into the house with, like, Danny actively targeting her too, I think is really just indicative of her really not being that good of a player. I really found her game this season to be pretty bad overall, but the only reason she's not lower on the list is because, again, I mean, she did come in here with a big target, which is something that Nicole Anthony didn't have against her. Kacer was someone that was about to go home the first week if he hadn't won another comp, and Janelle was someone that Cody was never targeting, so at least you have to give her credit for that. Janelle more than likely doesn't go home in week one under any scenario. Week two, Memphis was keeping her safe as well. So, I mean, really, week three, the week that she does eventually go home, is really the first week that she was actually in true danger. So, for me, that's enough to put her here at number 14. Now, number 13, and I know some people will be questioning why this person isn't at the very bottom, considering they were the first boot of the season. But at 13 here, I do have Keisha. And again, the reason why she's not the very bottom is because I think she came into this game with absolutely no shot. The thing is, like, Keisha was an alternate coming into this season. She literally wasn't on the cast until Casey had to drop out. So because of that, Keisha wasn't able to pregame at all. And she comes into this season with no real reputation within the modern Big Brother community. Obviously, she's a massive fan favorite from Big Brother 10, a massive figure. Obviously, Keisha's birthday is this massive moment for the show, but most modern players don't remember it. And because that, Keisha came into this season with such an uphill road ahead of her, because it's like none of these people know who she is, or at least very few of these people know who she is, and they didn't really have the opportunity to get to know who she is, considering she wasn't really that much in the rumor mill until very late into the process. I think she also gets unlucky with who won HOH, and that being Cody, someone who again, literally had no clue who she was, because I do think there are other HOH scenarios where she is safe in that first week. She's also unlucky at the fact that, again, Kacer won the safety suite. If Kacer didn't win the safety suite and Kacer had lost the veto as well, Kacer more than likely goes home. Again, like, Keisha wasn't the initial target on that first round, and the fact that she does eventually become the target is due to unlucky circumstances. Now, does she handle the block? Well, no. I think she really did nothing. I mean, she did campaign. She did go around the people and ask them, are you voting to keep me? But then, like, they would just not give her a non-answer, and she would just, like, accept it. And, like, that's obviously terrible. Like, she should have been able to read that the votes were definitely not in her favor. But it's like, what was she going to do? I mean, like, I don't feel like she had many moves to make anyway. I think her fate was already sealed. I think she just got a really bad draw on this season. So because of those things, I do think she played better on this season than these other people that I think played actively bad, like Nicole Anthony and Kacer and Janelle. But at the same time, again, I can't really say Keisha played anything below like a bottom tier game for the season, as she was still the first boot. So she does end up landing here at number 13. Now, number 12. So obviously the first four on the list ended up being the first four boots of the season, but now we're jumping a bit. We're going all the way to eighth place here. At number 12, we do have David. And I mean, David is someone that I was feeling great about coming into the season, but I do think the more and more we saw him on the season, it really became clear he just isn't a good player. He made so many social and strategic mistakes within the season. I think we just saw that, like, straight up, David's a socially awkward guy. Even when he's telling the truth, he somehow gives off the vibe that he's lying to people, to where people like a Tyler or people like a Devon never really trusted him within the game, despite them having reason to trust him, especially Devon. And again, we might as well talk about like all the strategic mistakes he made, like him telling Devon that he was in an all-guys alliance when it turns out he wasn't in an all-guys alliance. But that really blows up his spot in week two, and that almost causes him to go home. I mean, there was a point where it did look like Bailey and Devon were actually considering flipping on him because of that. We do also have him blowing up Tyler and Cody's spots in week three by leaking information to Devon about things that they told him, which in turn caused Cody and Tyler to both do damage control to where they put the blame onto David. We also have him later on in the game where he uses his disruptor power but decides to just not tell people that he used the power, and through that he comes off as a joke there. We have him going for the $10,000, which I don't fault him for going for $10,000, but it is a bad look to the house. Like, him getting the money wasn't going to change anything real within the game, but it definitely wasn't an optimal move to make from a strategic point of view. You also have the situation of Devon after the Ian vote, where Nicole puts all the blame onto David and he's not able to convince Devon otherwise. Like, there's just so many points in this game where, like, David played actively bad. The only reason he's not closer to the bottom of the list is because he did get 8th place. He did make it decently far, and even when he was voted out, he was voted on a 3-2 vote, the closest vote of the season, and was so close to staying there. So I do think David played pretty terrible throughout, but there are some things to give him some merit for, especially like also him being able to bond with Christmas, him being able to bond with Tyler, and really Tyler, despite having David do so many things that sabotage Tyler's game, Tyler still trusted him by the time he left. Obviously, he tried to save him at the end and was crying over David going home. So, I mean, I do think David had some merit within the game, but obviously not too much. He does land at number 12. Now, number 11, we're on to another person I think played pretty terribly, and that's Devon. I think Devon played pretty abysmally this season, especially considering how good of a position she came into the season right from the get-go. I thought coming into the season, Devon was easily the most poised to win the game. She comes into the season with a reputation of being this really fun character, but not a strategic mastermind by any means. This person that you can trust, this person that isn't going to blindside you, this person that you would want to work with. And she also comes into the season with some relationships. I mean, she could have had a Cody relationship through Polly. She was able to build that bond with Bailey through Swaggy. I really do think she came into the season so well positioned and didn't capitalize on that at all. I mean, very early on, it did look like she was doing okay. I mean, she wasn't part of the core group, but she did have an alliance with Enzo and Cody along with Bailey, the Connect Four alliance. That did seem to be one of Cody's options early on, but I do think there's a couple things that eventually go wrong. I think first up, you have Bailey and Devon essentially becoming the swing votes. And through that, they actually do eventually consider voting out David, which I do think through that makes them look very sketchy to the main core of the house, especially when there was a point where Bailey and Devon got caught not telling Cody that Janelle was coming after him, which I don't think was particularly great there. But then you also have the factor in Devon just completely blowing up her own game for like no reason. And the fact that she goes around and starts testing people, she specifically tests Danny, but she wants to build this alliance. So she first goes to Tyler and says that she wants to make an alliance, then goes to Nicole Franzel and wants to make an alliance with her, and then goes to Danny and tells Danny that Tyler came to her to make this alliance, which causes Danny to go to Tyler. At first, Danny doesn't believe him, but then Danny goes to Nicole, obviously someone she trusts a lot more, and Nicole tells her that Devon was actually the one doing this. And at that point, that just makes Devon look so bad within the game, and it's for no reason. Like, Devon didn't need to do this, but this actively blows up her game to where Danny and Nicole are actively targeting Devon and Bailey, plus also they convince Christmas to eventually do so as well, which eventually happens on week 5, where Bailey and Devon are put on the block. Devon does stay in the game, to which you do have to credit her for building bonds with Danny after Danny found out that Devon was coming after her. I do think that is something you have to give her some credit for. Devon is able to make Danny and Nicole trust her once again, so that's at least one positive within her game. And we get to the next week where obviously all the shenanigans with disruptor power happen, and Devon ends up winning the veto and does use it on Kevin, which, while it doesn't really make that much of an impact within the game, and to be honest, probably actually harms her more than truly benefits her within the game, as while Kevin was a number for her, I think at that point, the numbers were already gone. I think it was more beneficial for her to try to integrate herself within the majority than to actually save Kevin there, especially because this causes some hostility between her and the people of the committee, to where they're upset that she was using the veto. But I do think this shows that at least Devon was willing to make a move within the game. Though, obviously, the very next week, she gets this really terrible read on David, and through that, I think she really just burns her bridges there. Though by that point, she was already so far on the bottom that it didn't really matter. Though coming into that week where Memphis was HOH, she wasn't the target right off the bat. It really wasn't until Tyler had won the veto and convinced Memphis to not backdoor David that she does become the biggest target. And that's largely because they were trying to weaken Danny's positioning within the game. So I do think she gets kind of unlucky there with the veto results, where if Memphis, Devon, or Kevin had won the veto there, Devon is more than likely safe. Though there's actually a chance that they vote out Devon anyway if she is on the block against David. But still, I mean, there's definitely a chance that Devon could have stayed that week, but obviously it didn't end up happening. But for the most part, I do feel like Devon made her own bed on this season. I think a lot of the reason why she was already in a bad position later on in the game is because of the mistakes that she made earlier on in the game. And also, she just gets really unlucky, like a lot of the players on this season, with how the competition's played out, where the committee ends up running the table due to the fact that they won pretty much every competition of the season. For me, Devon, there's not really that much to really praise about her game, especially when she came into this game with such high equity and just doesn't utilize that throughout the season. So for me, she does land at number 11. Now, number 10, we're on to someone that I know a lot of people really disliked throughout this season in terms of his gameplay, but I do feel like, for me, this is a pretty warranted spot, and at number 10, I do have Kevin. Kevin does have some really weak points in his game. Obviously, he does have some really bad reads, especially early on in the game, where earlier on, he is one of the main people convincing Nicole Anthony that Janelle and Case are after him. Mind you, I do think Kevin had some rationale for this thought, in the sense that Janelle and Kesa were actively campaigning against him the previous week. So I do think it kind of makes sense from his point of view, but still, it is still an incorrect read. Week 1, he is nominated, but I do feel like part of that is just bad luck. Again, bad luck that Cody wins HOH, someone that just out of nowhere decides to pick Kevin for the pawn position. He gets unlucky that Kacer had won the safety suite, to where there was a spot open for a pawn. Like, I do think Kevin gets unlucky there, and I think that really dictates the rest of the game. From that point forward, he's really just on the bottom trying to stay alive. Because, like, if we look at the first few days of the game, like, he was actually well-liked within the game. I mean, he wasn't being included in a lot of major game talks, but he was still pretty well-liked. And I do think a lot of the reason why he never really had much potential to move forward, to build on his position afterwards, was largely because of him being nominated, and through that being left out of even more conversations from that point forward. Again, he's also another one that just got unlucky with the comp. wins where, again, the committee just completely steamrolled. And through that, again, he also just had no real shot to do much. I do think he was one of the better competitors on the minority side, where we do see him win a veto, and that was an endurance veto. So, I mean, it was one that took some skill. We do see him come in second in some comps. We do see him do relatively well in competitions. He's one of the few people that was willing to target Cody throughout the game. But again, due to his lack of competition wins, he wasn't able to actually do so. He does build really strong one-on-one bonds throughout the season, though, with Nicole Anthony at first and then eventually Davon. But outside of that, was never able to, again, integrate himself within the majority. I do think Kevin played, to be honest, a similar game to how he played last time in BB11. I think the only difference is that the majority group never broke up, because he was always on the bottom of the majority in BB11. It's just that majority alliance wasn't able to stick together. Mind you, I could be talking him into play, but whatever. I think Kevin is still the same player. I still think he has a decent mind for the strategic elements of the game. I just feel like there were no cracks for him to actually squeeze his way into this time. And because that this time he gets taken out pretty unceremoniously. But I think in comparison to the players that we've already talked about so far, I think he had the most potential to make an impact on the game itself. So for me, he does land at number 10. At number 9, we have a former winner. We have Ian. And Ian is such a tough person to assess from this season, because I think Ian also played pretty much the same game as last time. I think he played a game where he wasn't within the core of the majority group, but he is eventually able to build an alliance with people that are within the core, with him building the four prime alliance with Cody, Nicole, and Danny. Obviously, last time he built the Quack Pack. But I think the difference here is that the Quack Pack ended up becoming a real alliance just due to how the competitions played out, while here, that never became the case. This was always a fake alliance, and Ian was always on the bottom of that. Ian does build a final two with Nicole, which I guess you can give him some credit for, but that was kind of a built-in alliance. I mean, he was really good friends with Nicole preseason, plus also the fact that they are both the only two winners on the season, so that's kind of a gimme alliance there. But I also feel like Ian was always like the second or third target for the HOH. Like, he was someone that was always looked at as like a backdoor possibility almost every single week in the game, but was able to survive it due to the fact that the veto was rarely used. And to be honest, I think his relationship with Nicole also benefited him a good chunk, to where people didn't want to put him up because they thought they would piss off Nicole. However, when we're looking at like Ian's actual gameplay itself, he didn't really do much. I think the most agency we saw him have was when the wall yeller yelled out that Cody and Nicole are running the game, and that caused Ian to go around and telling people's theories about the game, and this actively blew up his game, where like at this point Cody and Nicole get really frustrated at Ian and consider targeting him. So I mean, like, this didn't even work out in his favor. But the reason why he is so high on the list is because he made it to jury. He made it to jury as a former winner with that target on his back. So I think you have to credit him somewhat for that. Plus also the fact that the way he goes out is due to a lot of unlucky circumstances. I mean, Danny has to nominate Kevin and David initially. David uses his disruptor power, which causes her to put up Tyler. And it's once Davon wins veto and uses that veto on Kevin that she's forced to put up Ian and take out Ian. Like, that's so many unlucky circumstances to happen to begin with for him to be the target there. And even then, he actually pulls votes onto his side. He's able to get David, Davon, and Kevin to vote for him to stay. And really, a main factor of why he doesn't stay is because he wasn't in the committee alliance. Because, like, Tyler really had no business surviving that round. And a large reason why he does survive that round is because of his relationships within the committee alliance, to where Danny and Nicole, despite it being in their best interest, weren't willing to fight for Ian to stay in the game. Like, while the show portrayed Nicole as trying to save Ian at every opportunity, it's like, it really was Nicole trying to save face with the public more so than her actually trying to save Ian. So really, I don't feel like Ian had much agency within the game. He was kind of just snowed by the majority group the entire time. Though I do think he just gets unlucky with the placement that he gets. While he never really had much of an opportunity to actually win the game, he does get taken out due to a lot of unlucky circumstances. So that's enough for me to put him here at number 9. Now number 8. And here we have the final person that was not part of that main core majority group. We do have Bailey. I think Bailey still show that she has a lot of potential within this game. Like, I think the first time she played, obviously she has this massive downward spiral when she gets taken out, but before her HOH on that season, she was playing very well. She was playing the middle of the house very well. It wasn't until she was forced to pick a side that her game really blows up there. And here on BB22, I feel like she played equally as well early on, if not even better. I think she was more integrated within the core group earlier on. Again, as I said, like, her and Devon were able to build an alliance with Cody and Enzo, and there was a point where it looked like they were actually going to stay loyal to that. Bailey's also just a really good social player. I think she's really good at building bonds with people, though I think a lot of that has to do with the fact that she truly believes in those bonds herself. Like, I think she is too loyal to those bonds that she makes, and I do think that does harm her in terms of her strategic game, as we do see with Christmas targeting her in week 5, where I do look at that as a lot of Bailey thinking she had a game relationship with Christmas because she had a personal relationship with Christmas, but due to her not actively making a game relationship, Christmas uses the information that Bailey gave her against her, not thinking that they have a game relationship. Like, I just think that Bailey doesn't go far enough with her relationship. She doesn't talk enough game within her relationships to actively position herself well within the game. But yeah, I do think she still showed that she had a lot of potential in the game on this season. I think a lot of her downfall is, again, bad luck to a degree. I mean, I do think there are certain things that she did that were pretty poor, like her making it very clear to everybody that she has a very strong bond with Janelle, who was someone that was very clearly on the bottom. So by that, I do think that made some people just not trust her naturally. I think also the fact that she made it very blatant that she had a bond with Devon also harmed her in the game. And I think Devon's poor gameplay really just dragged Bailey down as well. As I do think Bailey was always in the position where if both Bailey and Devon were on the block, Bailey would have been targeted. But I don't think they would have been on the block together for a while if it had not been for Devon's poor gameplay. And also, we can talk about this, that the committee, when that alliance was originally being built, Bailey was actually supposed to be one of the members of that alliance. It's, again, through her relationship with Devon that Danny decides to veto that, and they end up replacing Bailey with Nicole. Again, if Bailey hadn't been associated with Devon, Bailey more than likely is within the committee and ends up running the season along with them. So I do think a lot of her downfall in the game comes through her relationship with Devon. But also through that, I think there's less fault within her actual game to really place on her personally. So because of that, for me, I do feel like she does land here at number 8. Now number 7. As I said, the top 7 here are the core 7 people within the game. It's the people that made it to the top 7 of the season. And at number 7 here, I do have the person that came in 7th, and that is Danny Briones. And Danny, for me, is so lucky that she's this high on the list. Like, she has no business being this high on the list. I think it's really, again, through the committee having dominated the season, that Danny is at number 7. Because really, I don't think Danny played well this season at all. And I think Danny's downfall was more due to her own actions than someone like a Bailey and even an Ian, possibly even a Kevin. Like, I think there's a serious argument for Danny being below all those people, being probably around number 10. The reason why she's this high, though, is because she was part of the committee alliance that ended up running the table. She was someone that was supposed to be targeted very early on, but somehow squeezes her way all the way to final 7 through being within the committee alliance. I mean, even week 1, she was someone that Cody was considering targeting that very first week. If it had not been due to her pregame relationship with Nicole, she could have easily been at the first boot that week, where Nicole is the one that convinces Cody to trust Danny. Mind you, I do think Danny also does something very well during that first week as well, where Danny is one of the few people that's playing actively. That first week, again, as I mentioned before, was like a lot of people just playing very passively, as I do feel like that is the meta of current All-Star seasons. But through that, the person who acts against that meta is the person who has the greatest chance of success very early on. Again, it's very basic game theory there. So through that, Danny is able to come off as an active player. And in doing so, because Cody was someone that was upset at everyone playing so passively, because again, he wanted to win HOH so that people came to him to build an alliance, with Danny being one of the few people to actually do that, I do think that puts Danny in a very good position early on. The problem is that she ruins that position very early on too. I mean, by week 2, she already starts to ruin her positioning there. She also gets in trouble for pretty much just spilling her entire alliance to Janelle at a point where she tries to make this deal with Janelle to keep her people safe, and that's not particularly great. You also have her relationship with Tyler, which was always just very awkward, and that causes Tyler to target her very early on. And again, by week 4, she is a massive target win in the game, to where, like, if a certain HOH had won each of those HOHs from that point till the final seven, she probably goes home. And it's, again, very, very lucky that she gets to the final seven. Like, Tyler and Enzo had been targeting her for so long in the game, but she somehow manages to get all the way towards the end game. And even along the way, she plays pretty poorly there as well, where it's like, again, during her HOH, she gets rid of someone in Ian who was much more willing to work with her than Tyler. Week 10, she gets rid of Davon, or is okay with letting go of Davon, who was someone that, again, was very much in her corner. Even someone like a Kevin, I think, is someone that was much more willing to work with her than a lot of the other people in the house. Like, I do feel like Dani just kept on chipping away at her position, despite her position being already very, very bad, to the point where by the time of the final seven, like, she was the very clear boot there. Though, again, like, I think something you have to give her credit for is that I think there were still people that weren't going to target her. While Cody and Nicole were willing to let her go at that point, both of them weren't going to target her. They were going to target someone like a Christmas first. So, I mean, I think you still have to credit her somewhat for having allies that weren't directly coming after her at that point in the game. But still, I think she played pretty poorly for most of the season. And it's pretty amazing that she still ends up landing here at number seven. Now, number six is another person. I can't believe this person's this high. At number six, we do have Christmas. I think Christmas played okay at certain points in the game, but then also played really terribly at other sections. I think very early on, I think she plays pretty well, actually. I mean, she was pretty well liked for her first few weeks. She was someone that wasn't really in danger. She was someone that was not perceived to be part of the core alliance, despite her being part of the core alliance. Like, she was someone that, like, Janelle and Kaser were trying to pull over to their side. She was able to build a decent enough bond with some people like a Bailey and Davon. She had a final two with Tyler, built one with Memphis, had one with Nicole, had a really good bond with Enzo, was eventually able to build a really good bond with David as well. Like, I do think there are definitely elements to Christmas's game that are very, very strong. I think the problem is that she's Christmas. And through her being Christmas, she has this massive lack of self-awareness that makes her come off to people very poorly. I think her HOH week was just very terribly done. I don't necessarily disagree with her going after Bailey and Davon once she wins the HOH, but really she shouldn't have won HOH to begin with. I mean, she had no one to target. Also, I think the way she handles that is really poor, where she tries to make herself look like the victim. And she spends so much time rationalizing her decision to go after Bailey and Davon instead of just owning up to the fact that she's doing it. And I think that week alone already ruins her jury chances. I think before that, she had a chance of winning a jury vote, though a slim chance. I think after that, she has no chance of winning the game after that. And again, that's why I do question, why do I have her at number six? But I do think her game had higher highs than pretty much any player we've talked about so far. I think something about Christmas that is very misconstrued is that people talk about how loyal she is. And I do think during BB19, she did have undying loyalty to Paul, but I think coming into this season, she didn't really have that Paul figure, especially earlier on in the game. I mean, she had Tyler, but even then, I mean, once Tyler tries to quit the game, I mean, I think from that point, like, she plays pretty individually. Now, she is part of the Committee Alliance and does mostly do what the Committee Alliance wants to do, but that's because it also greatly benefits her. And we do see she makes a pretty individual move at the final eight, where she decides to try to keep David in order to take out Nicole. Again, like, a lot of people just say that she's blindly loyal, but it's like, I don't feel like that's the case at all. But obviously, once the triple eviction happens, her game's pretty much done at that point. I mean, the only chance she had of doing anything within the game is if she had won a comp and possibly taken out Cody. But really, she had no real endgame scenario from that point forward. I mean, yes, she could have gotten to the end, but I don't think she wins in any scenario. And even then, I don't think she gets to the end in most scenarios. So that part of her game is relatively poor. But I do think there are higher highs. I do think she has very good one-on-one bonds with certain people within the house. And I don't think her positioning was the worst in the world at certain points in the game. So for me, she lands at number six. Now, number five. And how is this person at number five? Also, again, like, I think this is just indicative of the season as a whole, where I do feel like certain people played very, very well, but then almost everyone else played either mediocre or very poorly. And at number five, we have someone that tried to quit the game, and that is Tyler. Tyler's such a weird case on this season, too, because I think Tyler obviously comes into the season as one of the best players to ever play the game. I think he comes into the season having a pretty big target on his back, being known as one of these all-time great players. I mean, we do see people like Danny and Nicole and Janelle and Case are talking about how they're scared of him early on in the game. But despite that, he's somehow still able to get into the majority alliance. And like, this is the thing also, is that Tyler simply doesn't play nearly as hard as he played last time. In BB20, during the pre-jury phase of that game, he's playing non-stop. But on this season, we really see him just slack off for a good chunk of the game. It's not really until towards the end of week one that he starts doing things. He does have this like really weird thing where like he doesn't play for like 99% of week one, but then all of a sudden, like within like an hour period, he makes multiple final twos. I mean, he has a final two with Christmas. He has a final two with David, has a final two kind of with Cody. But I also feel like his relationship with Cody is one of his weaknesses in his game, where like he does build this bond with Cody very early on, but he never manages that relationship from that point forward. And if he does manage that relationship, it's a lot of it's within the context of the triple threat of him, Cody, and Enzo. It's very rarely Cody and Tyler bonding over really anything. And I feel like that is a massive downside of Tyler's game on this season. And I think that's shown where, like, it's not really until, what, day 6 or 7, pretty much when the committee is put together, that Cody and Tyler reconnect within the game. So he does have a very rocky first week. But from that point forward, I think he does pretty well within the game. I mean, obviously, he does win HOH and has the target Janelle for his positioning in the game. But at that point, Janelle and Case are coming after him. And again, he's trying to keep them in the game, but it's just by them keep on targeting him, he really just can't do it. It doesn't make sense for him to do so. But throughout this time, we see some really impressive stuff from Tyler. I mean, again, when David blows up his game, he's able to quickly recover from that. He's able to get Bailey and Devon back on his side and get them to blame David for everything that he did. The very next week, he's able to convince both Bailey and Devon, plus also Enzo, to flip against Danny and do something against Cody's best interest, which again, rarely happens within this season. The thing is, though, I do think he also gets outplayed by Cody during this week, where Cody does tell him to not tell Enzo about the committee, and in turn, Cody goes and tells Enzo about the committee, which furthers their bond, which eventually does bite Tyler later on in the game. But I really feel like this is also where Tyler just lets go of the gas just entirely. Obviously, Tyler ends up trying to quit the game a week from here, and at that point, he didn't really care about his relationships in the game. You can see that he stops managing his relationships with Bailey and Devon to the point where they go and fact check with Danny, which causes, well, Danny to lie to them, but it causes Bailey and Devon to fully not trust Tyler at that point and try to get him backdoored. You have him trying to quit the game and that doesn't go through. But again, that does massive damage to his relationship with Christmas, to where Christmas pretty much lets go of their final two. I mean, yes, she does say that she's still loyal to their final two, but you can clearly tell that she starts leaning towards the Memphis side of things at that point. And really, Tyler should have gone home that very next week when he's on the block against Ian. I mean, it's completely mind-blowing he doesn't go home that week when Danny is HOH. But yeah, a lot of that's not really due to work that Tyler himself actually did. It was just due to the fact that he was within the committee alliance. But again, still really insane that they don't go and vote him out there. But then from that point forward, he's really just kind of dead in the water. He has no real end game plan. Like, he still has the final two with Christmas, but that's all he has. And even that was something that Christmas was very clearly willing to turn on at that point. Like, she was willing to let Tyler go with her building other contingency plans, like her alliance with Memphis and also the Wise Guys. Like, I think Tyler really just lets go of the gas and is able to never really recover from that point forward. And I do think he becomes too hung up on this idea of taking out Danny. Mind you, I mean, by the time of the final seven where he does take her out, it's like, what is he going to do at that point? He's kind of dead in the water anyway. But I do think there were more optimal moves for him to make. I do think getting rid of Cody by putting up Cody and Enzo would have been a decent move. I think even better for him personally would have been to get rid of Memphis. And through that, re-solidifying his bond with Christmas and being able to work with her as a duo to take on Cody. And really, again, like, I don't think Tyler had much of a chance on this season to get to the end, unless he had won out. Like, there's really no path for him to get to the end. But still, at the same token there, it's like, if he gets to the end, he does win. Like, I do think Tyler was the biggest jury threat on the season. Even after he tries to quit the game, I do still think Tyler wins the game against pretty much everybody if he's able to get there. But again, I don't think that was really ever in the cards. But again, for me, there's just so many highs for Tyler's game, so many lows for his game on this season. But his highs are much higher than anyone we've talked about so far. Then, and to be fair, his lows probably are as well. But considering he did make it far into the game and actually had a real chance of winning the game if he got there, for me, he does land at number 5. Now, number 4, we have a player that did make a very deep run into the game. And I do think from this point, the top 4 people here are all people that played really great games on this season, in my personal opinion. But at number 4 here, I do have Nicole Franzl. And I do feel like Nicole played a relatively similar game to how she played in BB18. She does start off the game more out in front than what she would normally be, where she is directly being targeted by people like Janelle and Kacer. She's being looked at as like the head of the house along with Cody. And if she were to ever go on the block against Cody, I do think Nicole more than likely goes home. So I do think she was definitely in a lot of danger earlier on in the game, but does get very lucky by the fact that the people that were in her alliances do end up winning the comps that do end up keeping her safe. And really, I do think this lasts for a decent while in the game. I do think there are many points where like she could easily be on the block against Cody or Danny, but she just ends up getting really lucky with comp results that make it so she doesn't end up doing so. I do think she had a little bit of control earlier on in the game as well. I do think Cody mostly took the reins earlier on, but we do see Nicole being able to convince Christmas that Bailey and Devon are the people that she needs to target. And that is something I would give Nicole Franzl credit for. And to be honest, in many ways, I would say that you have to give her a lot of credit for this, because we do see Tyler try to convince Christmas to not go after Bailey and Devon and completely fail. So essentially, Nicole Franzl won a battle against Tyler in terms of her control over Christmas. So I do think that's something you have to give her credit for. At the same time, I mean, Christmas was never truly loyal to Nicole in terms of taking her to the end game. I do think Christmas was always more loyal to Tyler and Memphis than she was to Nicole. I mean, I do look at Nicole as one of the worst positioned people within that core group. I do think her and Danny were always going to be targeted had a member of the opposition had one HOH, or if even someone within her alliance, someone like a Tyler or an Enzo, had gotten power, I do think Nicole probably could have ended up on the block. And also, I feel like a lot of people overstate how much of a relationship she had with Cody, especially earlier on in the game. Because the thing is that I do think Cody used Nicole as a shield. I mean, while Nicole was using Ian as a shield as a former winner, I do think Nicole was being used as a shield by Cody as well for a good half of the game. And it wasn't until halfway through the game where Nicole finally loses Ian that I do think Cody starts to pick her up and actually start to have some sort of loyalty to her. But also, I feel like her losing Ian is obviously just such a massive blow to her game. Ian was really the only person in the game that I feel like was 100% a Nicole pawn. And through her losing Ian, she definitely worsens her position in the game. And I think what makes it even worse is that she did try to keep him and tried to convince Danny and Cody to not put him on the block, but she actually failed at that. And then after that, like, she spends more time trying to save herself in terms of her public image than to actually try to save Ian from going home, especially when he was on the block against Tyler, who is someone that Nicole had almost no relationship with. We then get to the triple where Nicole almost goes home over David, and a lot of the reason why she stays has almost nothing to do with what Nicole has actually done. I mean, it's more so due to her relationship to Cody, I guess, in the sense that Enzo wants to keep her in the game to keep his bond with Cody. But then immediately after that, she loses Danny, again, another one of her closest allies, though at that time she actually wanted Danny gone due to her not trusting her. But again, that does severely weaken her position in the game. And though they do get out Tyler next, by the time of the final 5, she's the only person left in the game to not be in the Wise Guys alliance, but is able to win HOH there and then follow that with Vito in order to get her way there of Memphis going home. But even then, that was something that aligned with Cody's interest at that point as well. And obviously we see her get cut at the very end of the final 3, where she really was going to take Cody to the end. Now, we have learned after the season that if Nicole had gotten to the end against Enzo, she more than likely would have won. I mean, obviously circumstances would have changed things. Like, if Enzo had cut Cody, then I do think Enzo would have had a chance there. But more than likely, Nicole wins. in the final two in that scenario. However, that was a scenario that she was actively sabotaging her game to where she wasn't going to get that scenario. Like, she was making every move in the game, especially in the end game, to get Cody to the end with her. And again, that's that undying loyalty that I just feel like is a massive flaw in her game, because she had winning scenarios, just like in BB18. She had winning scenarios against Paul, against James, but she actively wanted to take Corey to the end. And it's the same scenario here where she wants to take Cody to the end, despite the fact that she more than likely loses against Cody. Now, the vote is much closer than I was expecting it to be, where it does seem like it would have been a 5-4 vote, maybe a 6-3, but it would have been a lot closer than what the end result ended up being against Enzo. But still, Cody still wins that jury vote, because I really don't see how he doesn't get at least 5 votes there. But still, the reason I can't put Nicole higher on the list is because I just feel like she was actively doing what was against her best interest. And because of all those reasons, plus also the fact that I just don't feel like she was super safe throughout the game. She was definitely in danger, had certain comps gone different ways, unlike the top three, who for me were in much better positions throughout the entire game. So because of that, Nicole lands at number 4.
Now at number 3, we have someone that I'm very surprised played as well as they did. I think coming into the season, this is someone I had no real faith in, but they proved me wrong. And while the person definitely had a pretty rocky game overall, it was a pretty impressive game, and that is Memphis. Now again, like, I can't believe Memphis got to Final 5. Like, how did that happen? Coming into the season, he was one of the bottom place people for me on my power rankings. I really thought he was going to be an early boot through his very domineering personality. The fact that even last time on BB10, he was almost voted out pretty early on in the game. He was a massive target during that first week. And then by week 4, he's on the block where he survives by 1 vote. So I thought the same thing would happen again here for Memphis, but I think he played very well, surprisingly, despite him making very big flaws. I mean, like, we see him build the committee alliance. I think that's really the shining achievement of his game, is building the committee alliance, this alliance that does run the table. And I do think he has some rocky ideas within it. I mean, his idea of the alliance initially was this alliance would never talk to each other. I don't think that's particularly great. I think this was also alliance that he didn't really listen to. I mean, again, this is Memphis. I mean, he's someone that plays a very individualistic game. But despite playing a very individualistic game, he's trying to utilize this groupthink meta that we currently have within Big Brother to his advantage. And I do think that part of it is impressive. But through that, I do think that also makes him come off very sketchy to his allies. I mean, we see that in week 2, where they want him to target Janelle and Kacer, but obviously that's not good for his personal game. So he decides to go after David and Nicole Anthony instead, and that does sour his alliance on him. I mean, really, the committee, like, this is the thing that I have a tough time wrapping my head around, is that the committee was an alliance that wasn't a real alliance for a good chunk of the game. Like, the committee was just one of the many alliances that Cody had within the game, that he really had the choice of which alliance became the real one. And it's due to the fact that certain members of the committee that weren't involved in these other alliances, such as Memphis and Christmas, had won competitions, and through that were able to dictate the course of the game. But somehow we saw Memphis never actually become targeted within the game until the end game. And like, it completely blows my mind how this became the case, where again, he was looked at as this like Devin-esque figure very early on in the game. Like, they were looking at him as this leader that was going to be taken out very early, but that never happened. And somehow he reaches Final 5 really without much difficulty. Like, there's no adversity for him a good chunk of the way. We do also see him really play optimally, in my eyes, from a strategic standpoint. It's like, I remember, like, looking back at his game, I was like, okay, he made the committee alliance, but he has no real end game. Like, when is he going to start setting up his endgame? And then immediately after I started thinking that, he starts setting up his endgame. Like, he makes the Wise Guys Alliance, where he adds in Cody and he adds in Christmas. And I think his biggest flaw in that is the fact that Enzo was the glue within that alliance. And Enzo was obviously a very unreliable person to put your trust in. Where obviously we do see Enzo blow the Wise Guys up to Cody, which I do think worsens Memphis's position from that point forward. Though Memphis is another person like Tyler that I think if Memphis had won out, I think Memphis could have easily won the game, especially if he gets to the end against Christmas, which was his most likely scenario to begin with. Like, I think Memphis was in a position to win the season, which is just, again, an insane thought considering where we came from earlier on in the game. Like, Memphis is someone that very much doesn't fit into the current meta of Big Brother. I think he plays the game very much like a mid-school player of Big Brother, where he's a very individualistic player, where he's trying to play the game to his benefit. But he was able to, again, manipulate this current meta of big alliances and was able to make one of his own. Then again, does this work on most seasons? Probably not. I think he got very lucky that the alliance he put together was the one that pretty much won every single competition. But also, that was also part of his strategy, was to get all the competition winners together. And that obviously increases his odds of getting this alliance to the back portion of the game. So really, there's so many highs and lows from Memphis' game for me. I think he really innovated on the current meta of Big Brother, though at the same time, he didn't win. Like, he still didn't position himself well enough to get to the very end of the game. But I still find his game impressive for the most part. So for me, he lands at number 3. Now number 2, and obviously the top 2 here, it's the final 2, and you've got to know the order, right? I mean, number 2, we have Enzo. And this is the thing, I know a lot of people are really down on Enzo. I mean, people were really upset that he never made a move on the season. People were really upset that he essentially did whatever Cody wanted him to do. However, I think Enzo played a really strong game. I think for most of the season, I do feel like Enzo was playing a winning game. And really, I mean, like, even up until the end, I think Enzo was technically playing a winning game. I do think Enzo had a chance of winning the game even towards the end. I think the problem with Enzo is the fact that he's Enzo. I think Enzo is this person who, his greatest strengths are his social bonds. He's able to build really strong social bonds to the point where everyone likes him. No one wants to target him. And we saw that happen on this season where, like, literally no one in the game wanted Enzo gone at any point. He was never targeted. He was well-liked by pretty much everybody. He had alliances with almost everybody. Like, Enzo was so well-positioned throughout this game. The problem is that he never translated those social bonds into actual social capital. Like, he never actually used his social abilities in order to make moves. He used his bonds in order to stay safe, and that's fine. Again, like, I think what he was able to do with him being able to stay safe until the very end of the game is so impressive. Never being nominated, never being targeted. To do that on a 16-person season, an all-star season of the show, that is very, very impressive. But he never used those bonds to make the moves he needed to position himself for the end game. And we do see Cody just completely outplay him at that. Even in the end game stretch, I mean, Christmas was much closer to Enzo than to Cody, but she goes home. Memphis wanted to take Enzo to the end over Cody. Memphis went home. Tyler was, again, much closer to Enzo than to Cody. He goes home. David was someone that was closer to Enzo. Kevin was someone that was closer to Enzo. Devon was someone that was closer to Enzo. I mean, really, most of this jury were closer to Enzo than they were to Cody. I think the problem there is that he never made the moves to get the respect of the jury. They always thought of Cody as the person controlling the game, and the reason for that is because Enzo did things that made them think that. And to be fair, Enzo was doing things that greatly benefited Cody in the game. Now, I don't think because he's doing things that benefit Cody, that means that those things don't also benefit him. Again, one of the biggest criticisms of his game is him not making the move at the final 8, where he votes out David, keeps Nicole in the game. I don't actually fault him too much for that, because again, I do think his bond with Cody was so integral at that portion of the game that he did need to secure that relationship moving forward, as I think if he loses the Cody relationship, then his positioning within the game significantly decreases. However, the fact that he was in that position to begin with is something that you could criticize him for. I think one of the biggest faults of his game, we can look back to him allowing Bailey and Devon to go home. That was the only point in the game where he had more control within an alliance than Cody did, was within the Connect Four alliance, where it was Cody, Enzo, Bailey, Devon. And Bailey and Devon were sketched out by Cody, but were very, very close to Enzo. And that was the only alliance they were ever a part of where Enzo was the connective tissue between everybody. And the fact that Enzo just let that go by allowing Christmas to go after Bailey. Christmas, someone that he himself had a really good relationship at that point. And through him and also adding in Tyler in there, the fact that they lose control of Christmas to Nicole Franzel is a massive knock against Enzo's game there, in my opinion. I think there's also just many points within the game where Enzo just does things that are kind of irrational. Like during the Ian week, he talks about getting rid of Tyler for some reason, for like no real reason. There's points where he's targeting Memphis despite Memphis openly wanting to take him to the final two. Like, there's just points in the game where like I just really don't understand his rationale. But again, these things though are minor nitpicks. Like, these aren't the main reason he lost the game. The main reason he lost the game is because he simply couldn't win the comps that he needed to at the end. I think what he needed to do was prove to the jury that he wasn't a Cody puppet. And because, like, really at the end of the day, like, people say that, oh, he went to the end with Cody, Cody was always going to beat him. I do think there were scenarios where Enzo could have beat Cody had he built up the respect that he needed from the jury earlier on in the game. I think he needed to play more individualistically earlier on in the game, be able to win more comps and prove that he's playing the game from earlier on in the game. Like, if he had been the one to directly get rid of Memphis, directly get rid of Tyler, been the one to really hold control over the game, I do think Enzo could have won. I also think Enzo could have won if he cut Cody, if he got to the final three that we saw and cut Cody at the end. I do think there's a very good chance that Enzo could have won that. I do think if Enzo gets to the end against Christmas, he could have won that jury vote. It's like Enzo wasn't dead in the water at any point. Like, it's very impressive, even more so when you think about like these people that people say like, oh, just because you make it far doesn't mean you played a great game. And obviously we see that being indicative of players like a Victoria, where, yeah, she made it to the final three, never really in danger of going home, or like really going home. Again, she was on the block, but like was never going to be voted out. But that's because like no one cared about her. She wasn't a threat. That's not why Enzo was kept in the game. Enzo was kept in the game because he had such great social bonds to where no one wanted to get rid of him for their games. Again, for me, like, I think Enzo, now having played two times and both times making it to the very end of the game, both times rarely being in danger. I mean, I do think this is a better game that he played on this season than he did his original time. I do think he's perfected on certain things within his game. But at the end of the day, he played a very similar game. But the fact that he was able to replicate that game once again against a much tougher field, I think really shows just how good of a player he could be if he just got that extra oomph at the very end of the game. If he could win endgame comps, I think he could be one of the best players we had ever seen. But because he severely lacked that, ends up getting to the end and loses unanimously. But at the end of the day, I feel like Enzo really showed how great of a player he was to get to the very end of an all-star season, never being targeted, never being on the block, never even having a real chance of going home at really any point in the season. That is so impressive to me. It's just, I wish he could have grabbed the reins of the game and take control at certain points, instead of just being a more passive player like he was. Because he was in the position to dominate the game, he just never actually was able to dominate it, unlike the person we have at number one. So he lands at number two. Not number one. It's Cody. There's no other option here. Cody played, again, the most dominant game of Big Brother I have ever seen. I think he played one of the most impressive games to have ever been played on any reality TV show. I mean, the fact that on Big Brother, he secures his win by the time the final four veto being played is very impressive. Cody really just dominates the season from beginning to end. He obviously wins that first HOH, which allowed him to really set up the game structure. I mean, he was able to build this massive power structure around him that really allowed him to stay safe within the game, no matter who he was going to be up against. Like, there were definitely people that were targeting him. Obviously, Janelle and Kacer were directly targeting him, but he stays under almost every scenario. The only scenario that he actually goes home is if he's put up against Enzo. And that was a scenario that was very unlikely to happen, as many people didn't connect that Cody and Enzo were such a strong duo early on. They were able to do a pretty good job at separating themselves to the point where everyone thought Cody was with Tyler, not with Enzo. But Cody in that first week is able to build so many alliances that really keep him safe throughout the rest of the game. He builds the route with Enzo. He has a final two with Nicole. He makes a final two with Memphis called the Commission. Through that, they also have the Committee, which is obviously the alliance that ends up running the game. But many people talk about this as, like, again, the Committee running the game, but really, it was Cody running the game. The Committee just ended up being the alliance within Cody's power structure that ended up winning the competitions that allowed them to control the game. Again, if it wasn't for Memphis and Christmas winning those specific HOHs that they had won, Cody would have probably gone with another alliance and stuck true to that alliance over the Committee. But because Christmas and Memphis were winning certain competitions, it really turned the Committee into a real alliance when it was originally made as a joke. Through the route, he also had the Core Four, the alliance with Danny and Nicole. He had the Connect Four, the alliance with Bailey and Devon. He also has Team Freeze, which was kind of a fake alliance, but whatever. It was Cody, Enzo, Tyler, and David, which was this guy's alliance that David thought was real. Eventually, obviously, they take out David and become Triple Threat. But really, I mean, Cody was the center of the house. He was very clearly the person that had the most deals going on. He built the power structure that week, especially because like so many people were playing very passively that first week, which Cody was upset about because like he won HOH trying to get people to come to him, but instead he had to go out and reach out to people, and through that was able to get this structure to end up running the game. They're obviously eventually able to get rid of Kacer and Janelle, and really the only time he faces adversity in the season is during week 4 when Tyler actually starts to play the game and Tyler starts to flip some of Cody's people against him. I mean, important part of that is Tyler being able to flip Enzo against Danny. And with Danny being a pretty integral piece within Cody's power structure, that obviously would really harm his positioning in the game. And again, I do think Cody gets kind of lucky with the fact that Tyler does end up deciding to quit the game, which really just hands all the control back to Cody. But I do think Cody even handles that situation pretty well beforehand, where he goes and tells Tyler, hey, you shouldn't tell Enzo about the committee. Only for Cody to go and tell Enzo about the committee, which really solidifies that bond. And when Tyler, when he's on his way out, tries to tell Enzo about the committee, he obviously just dismisses it because like he already knows. Like Tyler's way too late in giving him that information. I think another piece of his game was getting rid of Ian. By getting rid of Ian, he really solidifies Nicole as a piece for him, especially because he's able to deter her away from Danny as well, which greatly benefited his game. He's able to eventually get rid of Devon as well, which greatly weakens Nicole and Danny's positioning as well. And really, by the time of the triple eviction, he essentially won the game. Again, obviously, there were scenarios here and there where there were chances that Cody could have gone home, but the triple eviction results were just so beneficial to Cody that he had essentially won the game. And from that point on, anyway, he wins out anyway. He does win the final 6 HOH and Veto. At the final 5, Nicole wins both those competitions, and through his bond with her, he's able to stay safe. He wins final 4 Veto and then wins final HOH. So, I mean, he really was in such a dominant position during that endgame, and through that point in the game, he's able to make moves that he can call his own. He gets rid of Tyler and is able to take credit for that. He gets rid of Memphis and takes credit for that as well. He makes the move at the end to get rid of Nicole, which really just solidifies his win. Again, like going against Enzo was his best case scenario because he played pretty much the same game as Enzo, but better. While with Nicole, there was at least the argument that Nicole had been a previous winner and her being at the end was impressive. But again, like I think Cody really just made the optimal move at every single scenario. Like while he did make some decisions that I was questioning at points during the endgame, where he definitely favored his ability to win a competition over his ability to remain safe, where I do think he put himself in positions where he could have been in more danger had the worst case scenario happened, but increased the odds of that worst case scenario not happening, in the sense of I do think in an ideal world, someone like a Christmas would have been gone at final 6 because Christmas is the only person in the game that's directly targeting him at that point in the game. However, Christmas is also much weaker in competitions than both Tyler and Memphis, plus also just has much less influence in the game and also less of a chance of winning a jury vote than those players. So he hedged his bets. He got rid of Tyler, got rid of Memphis, who were much bigger jury threats and competition threats, in order to get Christmas at the final 4, to where he was banking on the fact that he wins that veto, and he does. He does do it. And also that's another factor of he throws the final 4 HOH in order to get into a scenario where he can pretty much win the game at the final 4. Because if he had won that final 4 HOH, there's a much higher chance that Nicole gets voted out at the final 4, and through that gets into a final 3 scenario where he probably has to win out, where Enzo could have taken Christmas and Christmas was definitely taking Enzo. So by throwing the final 4 HOH, he gets into a position where he can make his own fate by winning that final veto and essentially winning the game right there and then, which he is eventually able to do. So I mean, like, for me, again, like, Cody is someone that dominated the game from beginning to end. He never had really any trouble outside of week 4, and even then he was able to handle that situation properly. I think he wins a jury vote against pretty much everybody on the season. If we're saying someone like a Tyler probably beats him, it's like he obviously outplayed Tyler to the point where that final 2 was never happening anyway. I really just find Cody's game here on BB22 to be one of the most impressive games ever played, one of the most dominant games ever played. He dominated every facet of the game. Strategically, he controlled how the game played out. Physically, he won the most amount of competitions on the season, won 8 total competitions, one away from the record that Janelle has. And socially, he had the most amount of bonds that were able to keep him safe within the game outside of probably Enzo. But even then, there's a serious competition between the two. I mean, like, while Enzo was 100% safe, Cody was like 99% safe. But that piece of Cody's game that had him being unsafe in the game also allowed him to be the dominant figure within the game. It allowed him to be the person out in front, which is what he needed to do to gain the respect of the jury. And for me, I do feel like Cody played easily the best game of the season, but also one of the best games ever played. He ends up here at number one. So there we go. I mean, that is my player ranking for Big Brother 22. Again, ranking all these players based on how they played on the individual season. Again, it would be a different list if it was based on how they played throughout their career and how I feel like they are as players overall in the grand scheme of things. But to be honest, I'm going to do a video about that too soon, because I am going to be updating my top 10 players of all time list relatively soon. I would like to have that video out by the end of the month, so stay tuned for that, where we'll obviously add in the events of BB22 onto that list. And also, I just have some changes I want to make anyway, because to be honest, I do feel like I made some mistakes on my original list, but we'll talk about it when we get to it. But for now, that's the video. I mean, this is pretty much the end of my BB22 coverage. This is the final video that I'm going to be doing that's directly just talking about BB22. And despite the season as a whole being obviously pretty poor, this was a really fun ride. I really enjoyed making all these BB22 videos that I was able to make. For now, that is the video. That is my player ranking for BB22. Thank you for watching.